stop me and say to me, you know, you're doing a good job. We used to play in that park. We never ever had a problem in that park. Our kids, we knew our kids were safe in that park. And now they said they, you know, I won't even take my granddaughter down there. I won't even go walk down there because I seen all these needles in there and stuff like that. And, you know, there's people who come and pick up the needles and stuff like that, but until that time that they come and pick up the needle, they're sitting out there, you know? And some little unsuspecting kid who says, oh, what is this? What I do is I stand here and I bear witness for one of the atrocities that is happening here. And I take down license plate numbers of the cars that pick up hookers and any suspicious vehicle. Because there was a near abduction at a school over here the other day. And it just, sometimes there are people driving by that are committing B&Es, stuff like that. I mean, pardon me? No, I'm a mum watch. I'm not a part of anything.
Independent one.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Good,
thank you. Well, this call got started one day when we came down to see this little apartment over here. And I didn't see the activity in the streets when we came down to look at for the apartment. And I thought, okay, it's a little rough, but, you know, I can live with it. And that night, after we moved in, that night, I'm going, what is that ruckus in the streets? And all of a sudden, I'm hearing, Lisa, do you got 10 more bucks? I got to find some more crack. He only gave me 7 rocks and I'm supposed to get 10. And I'm going, my God, what is going on out there? You know, and here I look, and there's about 7, 12 deep at the old Balmoral, just smoking crack like you would not believe. And then the next day, I come and walk to McDonald's because I didn't feel like, see, there's a dealer right there. See, he's not turning because he's got the camera on. Like, I've been in rough neighborhoods, but I've never seen it so blatant here. I've never seen them so thick, you know. And when the next day after the first night we moved here, I walked up to McDonald's, and I realized then that my autistic son, who has Asperger's, would not be able to make it from our house that was right on that corner up to McDonald's. I knew right then he would not be able to make it because he's too friendly. Taking care of an autistic son is not easy. So I knew right then that I had to do something. And I knew I didn't want to be muffled. I knew I did not want to be a part of an association or a block watch because I wanted to be able to say what has to be said. I believe in tough love. I believe in if somebody comes up to you and threatens you, that I'm not going to stand here and be pretty about it. My mouth is not pretty. I do not, I tell them where to go, how to get there, and which flight to take. I've had about 12 to 13 death threats. One tried to set me on fire. Another one impersonated a policeman and told me of a man who was going to come and set me up to beat me up with bats. Stuff like that. They gave me a description, the whole thing. Here he is again. He's the dealer. He's the one that provides the crack for the over there. And I've given his license plate number to the police several times, and as you can see, he's still on the street. We have a love-hate relationship, you know. And a lot of people have come by and said, good girl, you know, you're doing a good job, you know. This may be the stupidest thing I've done in my life. It may not be a very bright thing, but something has got to get done. And that's the point of it all. You know, it's the Johns who are generating the money for the drug dealer. When they come down here, they say they use these girls who are half stone, who are so stone sometimes they don't even know their name, and they use these girls, and then they bring them back, and then we have to deal with the aftermath. We as a community, and they go back. The hypocrites go back to where they're nice little houses and their nice little knife life, and we have to stay here and watch it all go down day after day after day. And the children see this day after day after day. So if we do not want any more addicts on this street, I suggest somebody comes and helps. because we cannot do this alone. This is ridiculous. The hookers have come up to me and said, you're making it hard for a girl to make a living out here. And then have threatened me after that. But there are some that have gotten off the street or have moved on or elsewhere from this corner. And that's my point. I mean, like, we have to do something to either move them on, catch the dealers, do whatever, because something has got to get done, you know? Because I'm sick and tired of this. I'm sick and tired of watching police go by and not be able to do anything. And that's another aspect for what's happening around here, is that the ambulance and the police are, especially the ambulance, they're called for overdoses, they're called for hookers getting beat up, they're called for all of that sort of stuff, and they're taken away from people who may be having a heart attack, you know. I don't see how this can be ignored for so long. I mean, this place needs funding, it needs police. I've phoned them time and time again, so has a whole lot of people in this area. They are sick and tired of things disappearing from their houses, that they cannot walk down the street without feeling embarrassed, you know, about or intimidated. And there's some reports of older people who have been asked to give money, or, you know, can you loan me this, can you loan me that, and as soon as they see that they got some money or whatever, they'll shake them down, you know.
What kind of things do you see could be done or should be done?
Well, I think funding has got to, a longer rehab for these people, because when you pick them up and you drop them off at the jail cell and they're out 2 days later, well, you might as well give them the needle. And you might as well give them a little crack pipe with a little bit of crack in there, because they're coming right back here. They're not thinking about what they're doing. And, you know, a two-year rehab. I mean, show them some life, you know. Help them out. Do something. Put a roof over their head. Show them what life is really about. And if that cannot help them, what can I say? I mean, then they don't want to be helped. You know, you can only do so much, and then after that, they're on their own. I mean, like, but if giving them a short rehab, you might as well just stick them right back down here, you know. I don't want to see them die. I don't want to see any harm come to them. I have buried half my family. I don't want to see any harm come to these people. Well, I wish that there would be more static people standing static like this, because it's obviously working on this corner. But then they go down that street right down there, and they pick up their johns down there. They go down the back alley there because they can no longer stand here while I'm standing here. And if there were more people, I know that they're going to get threatened and stuff like that, but you know, if you were in a group and you were standing static, then they would have to move on. And I would like to see this whole neighborhood, mostly at night, standing static, 4 and 5 deep if you got it. I mean, you got to show them that they're not welcome here. If you want this neighborhood to recover, you got to do something. You can't stand here and do nothing. But I've been through hell and back, and they can intimidate, they can threaten all they want. I'll take the threats, because I know where it's coming from, and I know who it's coming from, and I'll take it, you know.